Under close scrutiny from its new German owner, BMW, Rover has organised an unusual works outing, a Britishness clinic. Eight young Rover high flyers have been told to turn up at the company's car museum with three items they consider quintessentially British. Far from destroying Rover's British heritage, the Germans want to exploit it. Britishness, BMW argue, must be turned to commercial advantage.
Your invitations included your little bit of prep, your cracker of Britishness.
What I'd like you to notice about this hat is it's the broad-brimmed variety, which allows the English cricketer to swelter in the Jamaican sun.
What I've got here is a pair of riding trousers,
oh,
or jodhpurs. I'm not quite sure what they're called.
Oh, are you going to try them on for us?
No, I won't, actually. maybe later. They're just a very nice example of high-quality, built-for-use clothing.
A knotted hanky. I thought, you know, only the British are mad enough to sort of wear things like this on the beach, and they still do.
What do the British reckon they're the best at in the world? Humour.
Wit and humour.
Wit and humour, okay.
Creativity.
Creativity.
Scandal.
Scandal. No, good one. Mm. Hugh Grant, that's it.
The group is also asked to explore stereotypes associated with their new owners.
Mind's eye, Germanness, the sound of Germanness.
Very curt.
Curt.
Direct.
Direct.
Slightly rude.
Rude. Slightly rude.
Slightly rude.
Curt, direct, rude. What are the sounds? Come on, tell me about the sounds.
Hard. Yeah.
Arrogant. Hard. Hard. Arrogant.
Abrupt.
Abrupt.
The sound of marching.
The sound of marching.
Dictatorial.
What's the Germanness sound of industry?
Clean whir.
Yeah. Clean whir. Yeah.
Think more banging.
This is sort of mechanical. I know this is completely against what everyone says, but it doesn't strike up anything for me.
It doesn't?
When I think of Germany, I think of absolutely nothing. People with no character, no personality.
No character, no personality.
But there is a positive aspect to this, in the sense of... when you want to get something done, it generally happens. Mm. You know, buses go on time, they look okay.
Efficient.
It's efficient, yeah.
Efficiency.
And effective.
At the London Motor Show, Rover is about to launch its latest car to the public. Rover hopes the new 200 will put to rest its pipe and slippers image. The bank manager's car of the 1950s, reliable but fuddy-duddy, is to be replaced by a hip hatchback aimed at the young couples market.
You're in the car and they come over to look at you.
Pretend it was the old days and you had a mirror.
Yeah,
all right.
Bit of that.
All that
bit of that in the handbag.
Oh,
but will all this be enough to seduce a style-conscious press? It's an important day for Rover's chief executive, John Towers. The press and BMW will be following every move.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you'll join us in celebrating the new Rover 400 5-door and now the new Rover 200. We make a very wide range of products now. We've got a lot of new cars, the 600, the 400, this is the 200. What a fantastic range, never been better, and it's difficult to match by the competition.
The launch is a success, but Rover still hasn't come up with an advertising strategy. Traditional and British, or trendy and modern? What's the new car supposed to be? Modern Rover needs to create a single, strong identity, like BMW.
There's always a slight fiddle, but then
I wouldn't really want the clip-on variety.
This is the man responsible for BMW's enviable identity in Britain. Robin White has been the German's advertising man for 17 years and a consultant to Rover for 2 months. Today, the millionaire is off to Birmingham to drop a few bombshells on John Towers and the Rover board. There's no question what BMW claims to stand for: precision, engineering excellence, the ultimate driving machine. But can Robin White work the same magic with Rover?
After years of turmoil, they're trying to find something, a flag to rally around, and they've got an enormous process going on inside the company at the moment, looking at, you know, what are their values, what should they believe in. And I think the reason why Rover has tried to add some youthful dimensions to its brand and talk about fun and excitement, which aren't essentially core Rover values at all, is because it was lumbered with having to sell cars in the small car market, where those are important things that people want. So, you know, if you're selling a Fiesta at Ford, you can give it some youth and excitement. You can do the same with a Clio at Renault. Rover had to distort and dilute its name to mean things like youthful and fun and exciting, which doesn't really belong to it.
But for now, BMW hasn't got its hands on Rover's advertising. It's still with Stuart Kendall, who's devised Rover's ads for the past 12 years. His brief for the 200 is different, to steer away from traditional Rover images. His solution is codenamed Stunning.
Today we're presenting the scripts, the creative routes, the recommendations for the new R3, the new Rover 200. Quite a dramatic design and a revolutionary car for Rover. And a very tough advertising task. So today is the meeting when we go wide to them and the researchers and the analysts with our creative recommendations for the new Rover 200. And a quick cup of tea.
The Montego 1.6L. It's capable of accelerating from 0 to 60 more than 2 seconds faster than the Ford Sierra 1.6L. Usually.
Stuart is perhaps best remembered for his wacky Montego ad, made in the bad old days when Rover was British Leyland.
Montego 1.6L. Doesn't hang about.
The ad's not typical of Kendall's work. Usually he emphasizes traditional Rover qualities: elegance, comfort, understatement.
You're about to hear something you won't hear very often. Cars built this well are few and far between.
We do know from research that BMW stands for some very key values, whereas Rover stands for other key values.
Du hast einige Leute.
In a funny sort of way, one is the alter ego of the other.
Warum? Darum. Wenn ich die Wahl hätte.
They aren't actually competing with each other. The driver profile is different. I believe when you're born a Rover driver, or you're born a BMW driver. They stand for different things in the marketplace, and there's room for both to coexist happily.
Faszinierendes Gebäude, nicht?
Ja, stimmt.
Britischer Architekt.
They did some advertising, deliberately attacking BMWs. They did a commercial where they actually featured some Germans driving a Rover in Germany, talking about modern British values, which was a direct attempt to be a British BMW. So in that sense, the enemy has captured them, and now one of the enemy generals is advising them on strategy.
Well, quite. We're going to put it together and edit first.
Right. Right. Because they're good, aren't they?
They are very good.
The finance scripts, which I think are great. Mm-hmm. Yeah? They're a little bit risky because they're a bit, little bit un-Rover, but they're witty, they're charming, they're highly memorable. We need to talk at some stage.
At his advertising agency in London, Stuart rallies the troops for the Rover pitch.
So when are you free? You, me and Joe. Great scripts, those, okay? Bit risque, very un-Rover in the traditional sense, but I think they're terrific. There's a step change needed, and rightly so. The management of Rover are far more visionary, far more ambitious now. And it's a very refreshing time because for the first time, we have to define what Roverness is and find a communication that actually represents that. So the Rover 200 advertising is a part of that.
What I'm going to tell Rover today is that they must manage their brand properly. They must recognise what their brand is, which is Rover. That they must settle on a word, two words, as the grit around which the pearl of the brand can be created. I'm going to tell them that they've got to change their company name, but I'm going to tell them that if they do those things, they can be a really successful brand again, that Rover can be revived.
Robin White isn't just an advertising man. He calls himself a brand architect. But will John Towers like his style? In London, Rover's advertising executives arrive to decide if Stuart's idea is indeed stunning.
Okay, the group we're putting into research picks up on the unexpectedness of this car from Rover, the drama perhaps that's needed. It's a youthful, more youthful car than usual, if you like, the 600 equivalent we've done so far. So here's a campaign idea. Maybe it's too zany, maybe it's too wacky. Let's test it. Let's see this scenario. Is it too left field? We open on a man lying down silhouetted against a clear blue sky. And as the camera pulls back, we see that another man is tying his legs together with a length of elastic. Strange, we think. And when we pull back, we see that he's actually lying on the parapet of a bridge. He's a bungee jumper. He shuffles to his feet and towards the parapet, actually stands on the parapet. We see his point of view as he goes way over the edge, and lo and behold, way down there is the car. Fortunately, the sunroof is open, because at the point of maximum stretch of the elastic, zoing, his head goes through, head and shoulders go through the roof of the car. And for a split second, we see him upside down, looking around inside the car, and we see what he sees, which is the interior, before the elastic, zoing, pulls him out again. And then the voiceover says, with a startlingly modern interior, the new Rover 200 is stunning, whichever way you look at it.
Stunned is how John Towers is feeling.
What you have at the moment, in my view, is brand schizophrenia. You have different advertising radiating different personality signals, and that creates enormous inconsistency. Rover advertising messages 1990 to 1994. We analysed £150 million of advertising to see what messages the advertising was communicating. And what we're saying is that only a third of the ad spend was actually on real Rover values. 100 million was on other things. And this was all very self-cancelling. And, you know, and consumers get confused. What is this thing? And they'll go back again to the past and anchor into past values. So with all this self-cancelling communication, I can quite understand why relaxed motoring has come to mean old-fashioned and not for me, because of this particular process that I've been describing.
Here's a funny one. Is this relevant or not? I don't know. Using Aardman-style animation, we know that style of animation where there's little puppets, very, very human-like, they move. We have a mole family with little check waistcoats on. There's mother, father, two children sitting around a dining room table. And they're all going, whatever moles do. And suddenly the whole room starts to shake. When the pictures fall off the wall, the teapot falls, and the mole family look shocked. And they all scurry around looking very alarmed, out of the room, up this flight of stairs, and with extreme caution they open this trap door, and having got it open, Daddy Mole, he looks, he's a huge beast standing over him, and he beckons to the others, and they all go and this thing drives off. It's a car exposing the sunlight, and they all put their little Wayfarer sunglasses on because it's so bright, and go back down. In you cut to the pack shot. And the camera goes in on the pack shot, up, over, round, and out. The new Rover 200, stunning, whichever way you look at it. Could be fun.
The admin may be having fun, but back at HQ, the very name Rover is under attack.
The Rover Group should cease to be the company's name. You need a new name that reflects the full portfolio of brands, one of which is Rover, which is obviously quite a controversial remark to make. I haven't yet been hit. I'm not necessarily saying it's a British Motor Corporation again, but the principle, I think, is correct. You have to find a name there to cover this group. Yeah, yeah. Hold on, you should change your battery. It's about to go. Yeah,
is that you or the computer, Robin?
This is my battery's about to go, so... Oh, let's just move on quickly, hold on. I don't know what's about doing that. Oh, well.
We do have 240-volt main supply here, if it's interesting.
I left my plug foolishly downstairs anyhow, so...
The issue on naming is not a name, it's the fact that it shouldn't be Rover. So, besides exactly. your concern, it plays no role other than just it's moving very, from where we are
yeah,
today.
Yeah, but it is very important that it's not Rover.
If we spent a lot of money next week on some highly expensive and extremely profound approach to the group's name, people inside the company wouldn't understand what the hell we were doing, given that we had all of these other very important priorities to attend to in terms of the fundamentals of Rover. Mm. So that has to be a part of the conversation as well.
Mm. Well, that's really the end of my presentation.
Well, thank you for that. It certainly was multimedia.
Hopefully not multi-logic.
Rover is worried that stunning isn't British enough, so without telling Stuart, they ask another team from the same agency to come up with an alternative. Responsible for the Have a Break, Have a Kit Kat slogan, the new team has come to scour the 200 for signs of traditional Roverness.
Leatherfin's terrific. There you go, lots of wood in the bag.
Yeah, that's good.
Well, it does go on forever, doesn't it?
The kind of very traditional Rover badge, yeah. but in a kind of rather odd setting. Okay.
Billy Mawinney is art director.
Sound great, yes.
Nick Welsh writes the script.
Is that a standard drill, or will that fit? As soon as you open the door, you've got a running board that says Rover. You've got a badge solidly in the middle. I love it. I mean, you see this little thing in the door, it just feels so British, really, little graphics. Kind of Conrun or Habitat or something, really, you know.
Well, I can understand why they're looking for new people to buy it, because it doesn't quite look like a Rover, but I suspect it might feel like one.
Rover's marketing director, Rod Ramsey, brought in the new team. Will he be any more impressed with their ideas?
At last, a Rover for me is what we're trying to get. Now, but done in terms which are recognisably Rover, rather than by moving the whole goalpost, which is another way of doing it, which is to say, hey, this is a completely different thing. In this instance, we're saying, no, this is actually, there are Rover values in this, but actually we hope it's presented in a way which hits that kind of younger target, slap bang, dead centre. The jungle Billy referred to is New York. It's a kind of archetype for bad urban driving. He's an Englishman abroad, briefcase, maybe jacket over the shoulder, walking into one of those a parking garage in Manhattan.
Yeah.
And at this point, we probably bring in some music. But the idea is to show the Rover, this new, slightly unlikely-looking Rover, displaying Rover virtues in a terrifyingly unpleasant environment. And this is where it gets even more unexpected, because we open up and we're looking at serious loft space, vast, huge, so the car pulls to a halt by the kitchen unit, and you're going, that's all. At which point, American girlfriend hands through the window a mug of tea and a biscuit. And it should be an English biscuit. I don't know whether it's a digestive, a gypsy cream, you can have whatever you like. I don't know, whatever your favourite is.
Rich tea. Making your own
rich tea. She hands them through into the window. She's looking at him and going, I don't know, he's odd. And then he really kills it for her because he dunks the biscuit in the tea. And he nods, thank you, and remains in the car.
Right.
And as we pull out, we have a voiceover which we hope sums up our proposition, which is being comfortable doesn't mean being conventional. The new Rover 200, above all, it's a Rover.
I would respond to this one much more warmly than I would to stunning, which always had, to me,
just an essence of potential gimmickry in it that was not quite Rover. I think we should develop this proposal as the idea, and actually we should assume that what's on the shelf stays on the shelf, which is stunning, which is what stays.
With the new idea getting the go-ahead, Stuart's stunning campaign is scrapped. Shortly afterwards, Stuart parts company with his agency and with Rover. On his farm near Northampton, he has time to reflect on events.
Loads of expressions of affection for me, and sorry to see you go, Rod Ramsey said. Thanks for all your support and tremendous contribution. Never forget, above all, it's a Kendall. That was Rod. Bless him. Au revoir, somebody else said, that the immortal line, trust me, sums you up, and you always delivered. I never let him down. I never let him down. The strategists wanted something unroverish. Stu, your craftsman adds your Britishness, your traditional, all very fine, all very, yes, British and comfortable and nice and quiet and inwardly directed, but we want something far more potent for the Rover 200 launch. So don't worry about Roverness. Don't worry about those traditional values. Don't worry about the comfort and the elegance. And we're looking for Vauxhall Astra drivers to buy into Rover at this level. We're looking for Ford Escort drivers to buy into Rover. So throw all that baggage away. Do something different, if you like. So the stunning campaign was not born of Roverness. So there was hypocrisy there. But if that's what the strategists tell me to do, then here you are. This is how I do it.
Over 3,000 miles away in New York, the new Englishman abroad idea goes into production.
Here in the city of La Crosse, Long Island, that cold rain may mix with sleet or wet snow before it tapers off as well. 5-day outlook Thursday, fair but cold, but then milder by Friday with
cold rain.
Keep fingers crossed, hope for the best. I mean, I think we have a weather day. It's always better if you don't have to use it.
Okay, no deal. Check the gate. You're inside, behind the car. Car comes out.
You know, you think, oh, well, that's just a nice little few words on a piece of paper. And then almost the next minute, you suddenly realize half of the West Village has been closed down. There are hundreds of trucks everywhere. And you're tempted to go, I didn't mean it. It was just an idea. You know, I didn't. But here we all are. If it works, this commercial is all about that point of identification with this young man who's in New York. Here's the story. Yes, he drives home. He's an Englishman in New York. He likes his comforts and he will go to quite unreasonable lengths to keep them.
It's a beautiful car.
You kind of sold me on it, actually. I've only been here for a couple of minutes.
Well, it's English with a twist. Well, I'm not convinced by the tie, but I think it's kind of the suit. I mean, the suit is kind of trad, but slightly different. The combination of the red shirt is just kind of different.
A couple of watermarks up here.
This was the shirt. We need to have a little bit, maybe like a sweater underneath here, because it's...
Stick your chest out, dear.
120 actors auditioned, plus 40 shirts, 60 ties, and 4 Paul Smith suits.
Oh, and it's done in 6 days?
If it were the same both days, then you've at least got 2 days shooting. But if it's actually snowing, we can't shoot.
I'm filming the snow to show to the weather insurer people to show that due to bad conditions and somewhat lack of continuity, we probably couldn't be shooting at this moment in time.
Running.
And
start camera. And
action, Kevin.
Kevin, freeze it there.
It's a funny thing about kind of propping, really. It's, you know, all the little bits should build up, kettle or the teapot.
It is unfortunately not a Proctor Silex blender, the blender with the brain, but it'll do.
So it's higher.
He's not the sort of chap that has his handmade shoes sent over from Lobb or Fortnum & Mason hamper. What he is a person set in his ways, and those ways could well include PG tips.
And a carefully chosen digestive biscuit.
It's a classless biscuit, I think. It doesn't have any problems attached to it.
Okay, action!
Got it slow. Quick!
That's getting better. Great.
Oh, this is good.
Great. Delight. Big with the eyes.
Just what
Nick
I've always
Billy
wanted.
Have cracked it. It
Nick
again.
And Billy have cracked it again. It's a marvellous car, that. I'll have one, have two sent round.
If my mother wanted a car, she'd have this one.
I can't drive, but I'd love one, just the same.
Going on outside, you'll always feel really good inside.
Total production cost £750,000. Quarter of a million more than the new BMW commercial.
If BMW advertising is thought to be better than Rover, it's because BMW is a clear-cut brand. It knows it stands for one thing, it stands for driving. It knows it stands for a certain set of high-tech values. Those are very clear. When you've got that clear background, it's much easier to do communication. When you've got a fuzzy, blurry brand, it's much harder to do tightly focused communication.
This is Robin White's latest advertising solution for BMW, and he thinks he's got the answer for Rover too.
If I was BMW, I would certainly want to add more people with a BMW background onto the Rover board. As Dr. Wright said there as already, I can see there's a case for adding more people from the BMW world to the Rover mixture, so you're the best of both cultures.
Like catatonic rabbits caught in the headlights, because they think people from BMW are scrutinising them, watching them, they do have an identity crisis to a degree. It's all blimey. What am I? What do I stand for? I better hire a consultant. And they get these guys in, and at the end of the day, they'll tell them only what they've always known. You don't need anybody from the outside to come in and tell you. You certainly don't want a German to come and tell you. Christ, if we don't know what Rover is, and we're British, God help us.
The competition to advertise cars may be fierce, but it's nothing compared to the struggle to get a job building them. Next week, Rover put a team of eager hopefuls through their paces for a job on the factory floor.